السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. The lesson, The Call of the Holy Land, Part 1, is from Grade 4, Term 2, last chapter. But in Grade 5, first lesson, Term 1, we are going to study The Call of the Holy Land, Part 2. So to understand that Part 2, it is better that we begin from this lesson and go on to the other lesson, so that we get a clear idea about what is in this story. I am a deserted and a destroyed place, all alone and sad. The stains of destruction and sadness have marked my land for centuries. My land is the land of prophets. Many prophets were sent on my land to spread the message, Allah is one. I am a deserted and a destroyed place. That means, deserted means there are no people or animals. It is completely empty. And destroyed place. Destroyed place means there have been before buildings and other structures, but it which were destroyed by war and battle. So many buildings were broken. The stains of destruction and sadness have marked my land for centuries. That means that Holy Land is talking about itself. The stains of destruction, that means the proof of destruction and sadness have marked my land for centuries. That is, it is facing problems not for one day or two days. It is facing problems for many years, more than hundreds of years. And that land is telling, my land is the land of prophets. That means many prophets have been sent to that land by Allah. Many prophets were sent on my land to spread the message, Allah is one. That was the message being brought by all the prophets sent to this land. Many rulers have ruled on my land. Over a period of time, I have seen just as well as cruel rulers. Some of them made me happy and proud with their justice, while some others made me mourn with grief and pain as they wanted to destroy and remove me from the face of the earth. My land was destroyed many times, but later it prospered and flourished. That means many rulers have come to rule this land. And there were both type of rulers. There were good rulers and bad rulers. Just means good ruler, cruel means bad ruler. Some of them made me happy and proud with their justice, while some others made me mourn with grief and pain as they wanted to destroy and remove me from the face of the earth. That means some rulers, they don't want to have peace. They wanted people to suffer. My land was destroyed many times, but later it prospered and flourished. That means this land was destroyed many times. It was spoiled many times, but later on, it also had good times. This is the picture of Masjidul Aqsa. Can you guess who I am? The Quran has called me Masjidul Aqsa. I am in Palestine. Commonly, I am called as Baitul Muqaddas. I also have the honor of being the second masjid in the world. Besides Muslims, I am also a sacred place of the Jews and the Christians. I was built by the angels 40 years after the construction of Kaaba. Later on, Prophet Sulaiman alayhi salam built me with the help of jinn. Today, I am an attractive and beautiful masjid. Even Ibn Battuta, the famous traveler, has written about my beauty in his travelogue. That is, the Quran calls this land as Masjid al-Aqsa in Palestine. And this structure is also known as Baitul Maqdis, Baitul Muqaddis. And this masjid is the second masjid in the world after the building of Kaaba. 40 years after the building of Kaaba, this masjid was built. And this masjid, also known as Baitul Muqaddis, is also sacred to Jews and Christians apart from Muslims. It was built by the angels 40 years after the construction of Kaaba. That is, after the Kaaba was built, Masjid al-Aqsa was built 40 years later. Later on, Prophet Sulaiman alayhi salam built me with the help of jinn. That was Sulaiman alayhi salam with the help of jinn built later on. Today, I am an attractive and beautiful masjid. Even Ibn Battuta, the famous traveler, has written about my beauty in his travelogue. Ibn Battuta is name of a famous traveler. And travelogue means anybody writing about their experience while traveling. That is known as travelogue. I was under the control of Romans and desperately waiting for Islam to arrive. At last, my wait was over. Hazrat Amr ibn As radiallahu anhu was on a voyage to spread Islam. He reached and surrounded my land but did not attack or hurt anyone. That was, this place was under the control of Romans and desperately waiting for Islam to arrive. At last my wait was over. That means this land was waiting for Islam to come. At the time, Hazrat Amr bin As radiallahu anhu was on a voyage to spread Islam. He reached and surrounded my land but did not attack or hurt anyone. That is, Amr bin As went out to spread Islam. That time he reached that land, that is Palestine, and surrounded it but did not attack or hurt anyone. The priest living in Baitul Muqaddis demanded to meet the caliph in order to give the possession of my land. Hazrat Amr ibn As radiallahu anhu could have fought and forcibly entered but did not, and asked Hazrat Umar radiallahu anhu to come. Hazrat Umar radiallahu anhu accepted the condition and chose to come all the way from Medina. That is, the priest living in Baitul Muqaddis wanted to meet the caliph in order to hand over the land. So Amr bin As radiallahu anhu, instead of forcefully entering the land, I have requested Hazrat Umar radiallahu anhu to come here from Medina. And Hazrat Umar radiallahu anhu have accepted that and decided to come to Baitul Muqaddis. Finally, the day of my freedom arrived. This was the day when Hazrat Umar radiallahu anhu gave me a new free life. That was, the land became free when Hazrat Umar radiallahu anhu was about to enter. When Hazrat Umar radiallahu anhu set foot on my land, it was one of the most memorable moment. Each and every particle of my land said marhaba, marhaba, with the sheer delight at the humble sight of the caliph. He was accompanied by a slave and not with a huge army. Because Hazrat Umar was coming along with a slave instead of a huge army. For a caliph, he was a strange sight. Clothes were tattered and torn, and at places there were many patches. His shoes were worn out. His hair was full of sand and dust. He was on foot and was leading a camel on which was seated his slave. It was a message to all the Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that in the eyes of Islam, the master and the slave are alike, and only Allah is worthy being the master. The priest who was controlling me blurted out, "Undoubtedly, you are the victor of Baitul Muqaddis and will remain forever." History is the proof that whenever a victor enters a conquered place, there ensues bloodshed instead of peace and calmness. But here was an example where Hazrat Umar radhiyallahu anhu waved the flag of peace and safety upon victory. That is, Caliph was wearing old cloth and torn cloth with patches, and his shoes were damaged, and his hair was full of sand and dust because of traveling long distance, and he was walking while his slave was on the camel. But this scenery was to make people understand that in Islam all are equal. Only Allah is the master and Allah is to be worshipped. So the priest who was observing this said that you are the victor of Baitul Muqaddis and will remain forever. That is, you are the victor. You are the winner of the Baitul Muqaddis. History is the proof that whenever a victor enters a conquered place, there ensues bloodshed instead of peace and calmness. That is, whenever a place is being occupied, it is always followed by war and killing and other harmful activities. But whereas here, Hazrat Umar came peacefully and calmly, and that sent them, the people, the population, the strong message of Islam, love and affection. The conditions were even drawn for the Christians and Jews to stay in the city with peace, safety and harmony, which was a unique example of unity in diversity. As per the conditions, the Christians and Jews were free to practice their religion. Their places of worship, life and wealth became the responsibility of the Muslims. After looking over all these arrangements, Hazrat Umar radiallahu anhu searched the place from where Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam had started his journey to Mi'raj, and his own hands cleaned the place. Then he requested Hazrat Bilal radiallahu anhu to give the adhan. Finally, Hazrat Umar radiallahu anhu led the prayer. That is, the conditions were even drawn for the Christians and Jews to stay in the city with peace, safety and harmony. That is, even when Hazrat Umar came and took over the land, Jews and Christians were allowed to stay there and practice their religion. And their life and wealth, everything was under the care of the Muslims. Then Hazrat Umar, after making all these arrangements, searched for the place from where Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam started his journey to Mi'raj, and Hazrat Umar cleaned that place with his hand. Then he requested Hazrat Bilal radiallahu anhu to give the call of adhan. After that, Hazrat Umar radiallahu anhu led the after the victory of Hazrat Umar, for centuries my city was ruled by Muslims. The crusaders repeatedly attacked me, but they were always defeated. Alas, when there was no unity among the Muslims, the crusaders fought many wars in the 11th century, in which the whole of Europe took part. They won many cities. At last, they set foot on my land as victor. That is, after Hazrat Umar came and took the city peacefully, For many centuries, it was ruled by Muslims. And the crusaders again and again attacked that city, but they were unable to win it. But in the 11th century, when the whole of Europe was in unity, the Muslims were in disunity, and that helped Europe to conquer the land and come as victor. When these people entered my land, they destroyed everything, and not a single life, be it old, young, woman or child, was spared. They burned the houses and the people alive. That is, when the victor, when the Europeans came into that land, everything was destroyed, including the life of old people, young people, women and children were not spared. They burned the houses and the people alive. When the Muslims took refuge in me, they trampled all the Muslims under their horses' hoof. At this time, my land witnessed the slaughter of innocent Muslims and Jews. I cried at this pathetic sight and slaughter, but the enemy did not pity anyone. Bygone were the days of peace and tranquility, and again my land was held in distress, pain and misery. That is, at this time, many people were killed, many houses were burnt, and many people were harmed under the horse hoof, and the days of peace and tranquility is no more now. The values learned: be kind to your enemies, be compassionate, be simple in your food and clothing, never be cruel. Area of intelligence is spiritual intelligence. And this is word back. Just, fair, morally correct. Travelogue, a book about the experiences of a traveler. Marhaba, an Arabic word which means welcome. Tattered, badly torn, blurted, to say something suddenly and without thinking. Ensues, something that happens afterwards. So here, this is the end of the last lesson of the term 2 book of grade 4. And this is part 1 of the story. So in grade 5, first lesson, term 1 book, it is the second part of the story, and we go on to continue with that. The Call of the Holy Land, Part 2. We have read the story of Hazrat Umar radiallahu anhu when he entered Baitul Muqaddis. Okay, now we continue the story. There was blood of innocent people on my land, and the cries of pain were echoing in the air. The crusaders had occupied my land. The Muslims were losing hope from all quarters, and their condition was getting worse day by day. When the hope was diminished, a new force arose on the horizon of the Muslim world. This hope was Imaduddin Jangi. He was the first commander-in-chief who laid a crack in the crusader's fort. Imaduddin was the ruler of Mosul, which is in Iraq. After conquering Syria and Iraq, he captured Ar-Riha, a very important place of the crusaders. This paved the way to the wonderful victory for the Muslims. After the martyrdom of Imaduddin at the hands of his own slave, his son Nuruddin Jangi took over the mission. Since childhood, Nuruddin Jangi was involved with the training of the army. He was a very pious man. He was not only brave and courageous, but also just and well-mannered. He was a wonderful leader and a brave soldier. Even the crusader respected him for his pious character. There were blood, that means many people were killed and many people property and buildings were destroyed. The crusaders have occupied the land and the Muslims were losing. The situation became bad day by day. That time what happened? There was hope. A new force rose on the horizon of the Muslim world. This hope was Imaduddin Jahangir. He was the first commander-in-chief who laid a crack in the crusader's fort. Imaduddin was the ruler of Mosul, which is in Iraq. And after conquering Syria and Iraq, he captured Arriha, very important place for the crusader. This helped in getting victory for the Muslims. And Imaduddin was killed by his own slave. So after his death, his son Nuruddin Jahangir took the mission. Nuruddin Jahangir became the ruler. He was very pious and he was not only brave and courageous, he was also just and well-mannered. He was a wonderful leader and brave soldier. Even his enemies respected him. When the Muslims were facing hardship and persecution at the hands of the crusader, the victories of Nuruddin Jahangir made them strong again. He liberated almost all the area near Palestine. It was his immense desire to free me from the crusader, and he even made a mimbar which he wanted to place in Masjid al-Aqsa, but he could not do so as he died early due to illness. He was only 56. Alas, I lost a son who wanted to liberate me, but my hope did not die. There was a young soldier in Nuruddin's army who got inspired by this noble mission. This was Sultan Salahuddin Ayyubi. As a youth, Salahuddin was never very serious with the affairs of the world. In fact, he was a spoiled young man. That is, when the Muslims were facing difficulties under the crusader, the victories by Nuruddin Jahangir made them strong again. He liberated all the areas near Palestine. He made all the areas near Palestine free. And this also made him place the mimbar which he wanted to in Masjid al-Aqsa, but he could not succeed because he died early due to illness. He was not feeling well, so he died early. He was only 50. But there was a young soldier in Nuruddin's army who got inspired by this noble mission. And in the army, there was a young person by name Sultan Salahuddin Ayyubi, and he was interested in this mission to liberate Palestine. This was Sultan Salahuddin Ayyubi. As a youth, Salahuddin was never serious. He was a free and jolly. In fact, he was a spoiled young man. As time passed, Allah guided him and he gave up all the bad habits. He became a dedicated soldier and a pious person, so much so that the noble life of Sultan Salahuddin Ayyubi became a source of inspiration for the people of all faiths. Although he was a spoiled young man at the early period, later on Allah guided him and he gave up all the bad habits. That is, he became a good man later on. and he became a strong soldier and a pious person. And that itself was a good example for other people to follow. His full name was Malik al-Nasir Sultan Yusuf Alauddin Ayyubi. He was born in a Kurd family in Tikrit, a city in Iraq. From the ranks of a soldier, he became the commander-in-chief of the army due to his hard work, humbleness, simplicity, and being a true Muslim. He never used any silk garment, as was the tradition among the rulers. He lived in a simple house instead of a palace. One of his major achievements was to gather soldiers from all the Islamic nations and made them into a unifying army to fight against the crusaders. Here again rose my hope of freedom, peace and harmony. Salahuddin Ayyubi dedicated his life to free me. His dedication could be seen from the fact that he left his family, country and all his comfort. His heart, mind and soul were completely engrossed to free me. He spent everything he had for this cause. That is, the name of Salahuddin Ayyubi, full name of Salahuddin Ayyubi was Malik al-Nasir Sultan Yusuf Salahuddin Ayyubi. He was from a Kurd family in Tikrit. It is a city in Iraq. From being a soldier, he became a commander-in-chief. Due to hard work, humbleness, simplicity, and being a true Muslim. After that, he never wore silk garment. He lived a simple life and he helped prepare a strong army by getting soldiers from different parts of the Islamic nation. Sultan Salahuddin Ayyubi dedicated his life to free me. That is, the land, the holy land, is telling that Sultan Salahuddin Ayyubi was helpful in making the land free. His dedication could be seen from the fact that he left his family, country and all his comfort. His heart, mind and soul were completely engrossed to free me. He spent everything he had for the cause. Once, he had blisters on his back, which made it impossible for him to sit down. But he never neglected his work towards me, which shows his passion and love for me. He even sacrificed food to the extent that he ate a few bites in 3 days. Or survived on juice during combat. That is, he had a problem which made him difficult to sit down, and although he had that problem, he did not move away from his duty. He even ate little food to concentrate on the work. On the battlefield, his state would be like that of a mother who lost her only child. He used to run across the rows of warriors and cry for help. Help Islam, help Islam. He believed that Allah has chosen him to free Palestine. While fighting, he went around the soldiers and encouraged them to fight to free Palestine. Many wars were fought between the crusader and Salahuddin's army, and every time Allah made Salahuddin's army victorious. The final war to liberate me was fought at a place called Hittin. A fierce battle was fought between the two armies. The army of the crusaders, which had come from Europe, was 20 times bigger than the army of Salahuddin. But Allah made Muslims victorious once again. That is, Salahuddin's army, if for example, if there was 1%, in crusaders' army, there will be 20%. Even though the crusaders' army was 20 times bigger than Salahuddin's army, with hard work and dedication, Allah gave victory to Salahuddin's army. So, after the final victory, Salahuddin and his army marched towards me. The sight of the leader and the victorious army marching towards me gave me immense happiness. The crusaders inside were asked to pay some money and leave the city, and some gates were opened for the poor who were not in a position to pay the money. All the crusaders with their wives and children were allowed to leave the city. This way, once again, Salahuddin exhibited the best character of Islam to forgive the enemy, and the city was won without any bloodshed. In this way, Salahuddin was successful in liberating me after 91 years. You should have seen my joy and happiness after such a long period. This day was 27 Rajab, the same day on which Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam went on Miraj. On that day, I saw the wet and teary eyes of Salahuddin and his army. He and his army showed gratitude towards Allah by prostrating on my land. He placed the minbar made by Nuruddin Jangi in Masjid al-Aqsa. So what happened? Salahuddin and his army were victorious. They won the war, and they allowed the enemy people to go freely with their family and property without doing any harm to them. This was done so that they understand the peaceful and harmless nature of Islamic tradition. This made the people happy, and the city was won without any harm after 91 years the city became free, and that too without any bloodshed, without harming the armies of the enemies unnecessarily. And all the people from the crusaders were allowed to go and leave the city. And Salahuddin liberated the city on 27 Rajab, the same day on which Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam went on Miraj. So Salahuddin and his army were happy that they were able to free the land. And Salahuddin placed the minbar made by Nuruddin Jangi in Masjid al-Aqsa. One of the kings who was taken captive asked him, "How come you allow us to live with peace when we killed your people and destroyed your place?" So one of the kings of the crusaders who was arrested asked Salahuddin, "Why he is leaving them without harming them? Why he is allowing them to leave the city without harming them?" Then Salahuddin replied, "I am a Muslim, and Islam does not allow me to do so." Sultan Salahuddin replied. Sultan Salahuddin showed the same compassion shown by Hazrat Umar radiallahu anhu at the time of when he entered my land. Here again was a son of mine who liberated me out of misery. Salahuddin ruled for 20 years, and during his reign, all the people came to know about his God-fearing nature, kindness, and his many other abilities. The joy and happiness that spread on my land gave me peace and happiness. Salahuddin was very famous among his people and in Europe. He is an icon of bravery. When he died, he had nothing in his possession except for 1 dinar and 47 dirhams, which was left as his legacy. In spite of being an Amir, his burial was done by collecting donations. However, today I am troubled again with innocent people being killed on my land. I call out for peace and await freedom. Is there anyone like Umar or Sultan who can bring me justice and freedom? That is when the king of one of the crusaders asked him, why you are allowing us to live with peace while we killed your people and destroyed your place? Salahuddin replied, I am a Muslim and Islam does not allow to do like that, that is to kill unnecessarily. So Sultan Salahuddin Ayyubi also followed the example of Hazrat Umar in showing compassion and love, and he ruled the land for 20 years, and during that rule people were happy and the land was peaceful. He became an icon of bravery, and when he died he did not have any wealth. He left behind 1 dinar and 47 dirham, and for his burial expenses donations were collected from the people. However, the Holy Land today is facing problem, and it is waiting for someone like Umar or Sultan to liberate. That is, it is waiting for somebody like Umar radiallahu anhu or Sultan Salahuddin Ayyubi to be free again and be a peaceful land. Values learned. Be kind to your enemy. Be compassionate. Be simple in your food and clothing. Never be cruel. Area of intelligence. Spiritual intelligence. Look at the meaning of difficult words. Persecution. To treat someone cruelly because of their race or religion. Human. Extremely large in size or degree. Minbar. An Arabic word which means pulpit. That is, the minbar is the place where Imam or Khatib stands there for delivering khutbah. Inspired. To fill with confidence and eagerness. Mission, important job. Tradition, handing down of custom from one generation to another. Unifying, to become a single unit. Dedicated, wholly committed to something. Engrossed, absorbed. Combat, fighting especially between armed forces. Liberate, to set free. Mi'raj, an Arabic word which means ascension, that is, from Masjid al-Aqsa, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam went on the seven heaven, that is called Mi'raj. Gratitude, the quality of being thankful. Compassion, deep sympathy for another who is stricken by misfortune. Reign, royal rule or authority. Icon, a picture or an image. Legacy, anything handed down from the past. Donation, contribution. Okay. With this, we have understood about part 1 and part 2, so that we can get a complete idea about this holy land. Thank you. Assalamu alaikum.